So the other thing I want to look at is imagination and future. And here I think that there is a certain kind of aesthetic of the self which is involved. And I want to argue over here that you can't limit the capacity to aspire to a given social structure because it is unable to account for the work of imagination and creating other notions of the self. So this is the picture of a very dear friend of mine who's a Muslim living in a different locality, a slightly more, you know, built houses, etc., but a locality which was put in place when in 1976 emergency, the Muslims were displaced from their, from their houses in certain areas under the assumption by Sanjay Gandhi at that time that that the city need to be beautified. And this always happens, that beautification means that people who are visible to the upper classes are removed to the peripheries of the city. But it's very interesting what he has done with his life. So here, in his house, this is a picture that I took from the wall of his house. And you can see his hand, he's showing me what the various pictures are. And you will see over here that that in one of the pictures, this second one, where you can see him holding a cup, you know, he's dressed in some ways as a aristocratic Indian Muslim. And there are other various pictures of him in presumably different kind of political gatherings. And it may not be obvious to you that there is a mixture of pictures which are actual real pictures and which are computer generated, right? So he has actually gone and got the picture of various politicians with whom he is standing in these splendid kinds of dresses. This is his picture of, you know, imagining himself as a kind of prince. This is a phase when he said he imagined himself like a Rajput, which is the, you know, the honorable, both Muslim and Hindu warrior caste. But then something else happens. After the demolition of the Babri Mosque in 1984, he begins to dress as an Arab sheikh. So he has the Arab headdress now. Not all the time. It's not that if you go to his house, you will see him wearing an Arab dress. But he insisted that his pictures would be taken wearing an Arab dress. But he's still completely committed to the Congress and will often have certificates about how much work he has done for the Congress and, you know, hoping to fight elections and become a very major political leader. So to go towards some conclusions, my first point is that the poor as a generic category or as defined by the discourses of state and policy making would not work. I mean, it might work for some purposes, but it doesn't give us any sense of the richness of the texture of these lives. Second, what is it to give a voice to the poor? And I want to write an ethnography in which there is neither a nostalgia for the life of the poor, like my colleague and friend Ashish Nandi does. For him, you know, all of that is fantastically, organically well-knit. It's not. I've been in too many, you know, heartbreaks in the last 9 years to be able to say that. But nor rendering them as creatures defined by survival alone, because there is a very rich imaginative life, which also I've tried to capture. So are there other ways in which we could conceive of the poor, which is respectful of their lives and yet not indifferent to their suffering? And here are other parts of thought. These are questions I thought I might address to major theoreticians like Bourdieu and Deleuze. So to Deleuze, I would say, how do different expressions of life unfold different spaces? So it's not like space is a container of subjectivities, but that there is a certain kind of unfolding. Second, that the spaces, as a Deleuzian analysis would make us think, the spaces we see do not have a center, they do not have a realized intention. But then how might we think of life as a desire or striving for the material and the moral together? To Buddha, I might say that we need to turn away from general reproductive machines. I would say that to Deleuze also, that this is not a matter of a general reproductive machine in which people are being processed, but that there is a way in which the social field is constantly being retraced. I mean, if you can imagine something like a tracing paper on which you take something, but when you trace this social life, it becomes different in some ways. And I think I would, in that sense, hope that these other parts of thought might render the poor as really worthy of our very serious attention. Because it's quite shocking to me that despite the huge literature on poverty in terms of how to measure poverty, in terms of caloric intakes, and I do not doubt the importance of that literature, but it is quite stunning to me as to how little actually is available on the kind of imaginary material social worlds that I have, you know, tried to give you a glimpse of, in which these lives in fact come to be embedded. So I'm really very grateful that something that is not about spectacular violence, but is about the way in which I think about the everyday as that in which one engages seriously the life of the other, is something you have given me an opportunity, however poorly executed at this moment, to present before you. Thank you very much.